Good morning. I'm Reverend Brenda Clark, pastor of First Congregational Church of Lockport, Illinois, United Church of Christ. Welcome to our YouTube service. We're glad to have you join us. Here are some announcements for this morning. First of all, we're glad to be back in the sanctuary this week. And if you could let your friends on Facebook know that you are worshiping with us on YouTube right now, that would be wonderful. This morning, we are going to be celebrating the Lord's Supper together. So please take a moment to get some bread or a cracker and juice or something to drink so that later on we can share communion. Sunday school will be meeting on Zoom today at 11 a.m. and they're going to be working on the Christmas program. And the Zoom link is in your Wednesday e-blast. The mitten box outside the back door of the church is for donations of hats, mittens, gloves, and scarves, which will be collected regularly and distributed to those in need. And don't forget, Craft and Chat is this coming Friday, December 18th at 5 p.m. on Zoom, and the link is in this week's e-blast. And now let's pass the peace. Those of you who have your cell phones, if you could text someone and pass them the peace of Christ. Otherwise, think about where you sit when you're in the church. Think about who you sit near. Think about who you get up to greet when we pass the peace together in the sanctuary. And as you think about all those faces, all those smiles, all those friends, pray for them the peace of Christ. And the peace of Christ be with you and all those whom you touch. Amen.
Good morning. My name is Carol Piccolo, and I am your lector this morning. Welcome to First Congregational Church, an open and affirming congregation where we serve with Christ, love God, and grow in the Spirit. The Edelweiss. This Sunday of Advent, we look to the Edelweiss flower. In the Alps, the Edelweiss is an expression of love and bravery. Since picking the flower means climbing mountainous terrain, it is also symbolic of dedication. For its elegance and beauty, the Edelweiss is chosen as the flower of kings. Its white petals in the shape of a star make it the perfect Christmas flower. We decorate the sanctuary with the Edelweiss flower. Please join me in our gathering prayer. The shepherds sat on a quiet hilltop, watching their sheep by night. They were common people like you and me.
The angels announced the good news of Jesus' birth to them in the midst of their work.
As Luke 2:15 through 19 tells us, when the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us now go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us."
They went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger.
When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child.
And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them.
We light the shepherd's candle, remembering the joy with which the shepherds greeted the family in the stable. Let us pray.
Joyful God, let us receive the message of your coming as the shepherds did, with joy and wonder. Make us curious to find out all that we can about you. Help us to discover the places in the midst of our daily lives where you meet us with your gospel and lead us to tell others all that we have heard and seen as it has been told to us.
Amen. Let us sing together the carol, "I Wander as I Wander."
Good morning. I'm Phyllis Huffman, reporting from a time long, long ago. Today we light the shepherd candle in the Advent wreath. It shines for the shepherds who were quietly watching their sheep at night when an angel appeared and announced the good news that the Savior, Jesus, was born. Here is one of those shepherds to tell their story. It was amazing. We were just sitting there in the hills watching the sheep when all of a sudden the sky lit up and the angels appeared overhead. It took my breath away. The angels told us that a baby, the Son of God, had been born in Bethlehem and that we should go see him. We hurried into town and found the baby Jesus sleeping in the barn. We told his mother, Mary, and Joseph about the visit from the angels. After a while, we went back to our sheep, praising God for the very special baby God has sent us. Thank you, Shepherd, for sharing your amazing story with us. Please join us again next week for another new story from long, long ago.
Here is the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ from John 1, 6 through 8, and 19 through 28. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. This is the testimony given by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny it, but confessed, "I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" He said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah said." Now they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him, "Why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal." This took place in Bethany, across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. God is still speaking.
Praise be to God. This week, the witness to the coming of Jesus is John the Baptist, who in the Gospel of John is not actually identified as John the Baptist. But we know him as, John the Baptist, because he did indeed baptize people at the Jordan River. He also prepared the way for Jesus, and that was his most important function. Now, John's ministry of baptism at the Jordan River created a stir among the Jewish people. They were coming from all over to be baptized by him. Even folks from Jerusalem were traveling to the wilderness at the Jordan to be baptized by John. The prophets talked about a coming Messiah. The prophets also said that Elijah would precede the arrival of the Messiah and announce it to the people. The people would have also liked to have heard from a modern-day prophet because of the times in which they were living. The temple leaders were concerned about the commotion by the Jordan, so they sent Levites and priests to talk to John. When they get to John, they ask, "Who are you?" John astutely answered, "I am not the Messiah." Apparently, he realized why the Levites and the priests were there. They were definitely not there seeking baptism. The priests and the Levites then asked, "What then? Are you Elijah?" And John replied, "I am not." The contingency from Jerusalem said, "Are you the prophet?" John said, "No." At this point, I think the priests and Levites are more than likely feeling some relief. After all, this guy at the Jordan River who's causing all of this commotion, even in Jerusalem, says that he is not the Messiah. He says he's not Elijah. He says he's not the prophet. So they ask John, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" And John answers by quoting the prophet Isaiah. I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord. When John said that, I imagine that the priests and Levites got nervous. He may not be the Messiah, and he may not be Elijah, and he may not even be the prophet. But he is quoting Isaiah, the 40th chapter, a chapter that promises God's deliverance, a chapter that promises the wait is over. The freedom of God's people is on its way. God is getting ready to rebuild and recreate Israel and return God's people back to their promised land. And if this is what John is saying, he is obviously not commending them as being part of the recreation and the rebuilding. That's when the gospel tells us that these priests and Levites had been sent by the Pharisees. So they ask John, why are you baptizing if you're not the Messiah, if you're not Elijah, if you're not the prophet? John answers, I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me, and I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandals. John's gospel says no more to us about the contingency from Jerusalem. They disappear from the story at this point. Their response to John's answer is left to our imagination. Now, how does John the Baptist, out in the wilderness at the Jordan, prepare the way for Jesus? He does it by saying as little about himself as possible. He answers direct questions with direct answers, but he chooses not to talk about himself. He points the way to Jesus, the true light that was coming into the world. John the Baptist says, this was he of whom I said, he who comes after me ranks ahead of me because he was before me. Maybe that's the lesson for us in this passage. Jesus, the light of the world, was there at the creation. He helped create. And Jesus, the light of the world, is sent into the world to rescue and deliver the world, to save us from ourselves. Many of those to whom Jesus reaches out during his lifetime reject him. And yet those who receive and accept the light and believe in the name of Jesus also receive power from God to become children of God. And we become children of God not by the blood or by the will of the flesh or of the will of humankind, but by God's will. It is Jesus, the light of the world, who became flesh and lived among us. And we have seen his glory, the glory of God's only Son, full of grace and truth. John's witness was open. He hid nothing. He who comes after me ranks ahead of me because he was before me. Jesus is whole. He is full. And from his fullness, we have all received grace upon grace, whether or not we realize it or acknowledge it. John is not looking to create his own group of religious followers. John witnesses by showing the way to Jesus, by fading into the background while presenting the greatness of Jesus. John is not worthy to untie Jesus' sandals. Jesus is the true light who brings enlightenment to everyone who recognizes, accepts, and receives it. Now, what does this witness look like for us? Well, first, let me tell you a story about what it doesn't look like. Several years ago, Mike and I were at a Sears in a mall, and we were looking for some khakis for Mike. And while we were shopping, and he was picking out things to try on, a man enters the store in a wheelchair, talking very loudly, and with him is somebody who looks like a homeless person. And what he says very loudly is, "Let's find you some clothes so that I can buy them for you, so that you can come to church and be presentable at my church, and you can come to my Bible study that I lead. Everybody will love the way you look in the new clothes that I buy for you." That's not really pointing to the way to Christ. That's patting yourself on the back and saying, "Look at me, look at me, look at me." And it got even worse because he looked around every once in a while. And when everybody saw him looking around, they all quickly looked away. And so then he got louder and said pretty much the same things over and over again. That's not the way to point to Jesus. So let's talk about a way to point to Jesus. There is a Presbyterian pastor, we'll call him Pastor Bob, and he ministered to a Presbyterian church near inner city Detroit. Bob had a hobby of carpentry and being a handyman, and there was a group in the Detroit inner city area that got together every Thursday night and went to the homes of people who couldn't fix their own homes up, and helped them repair things, paint, rebuild walls and woodwork and all of those things. And Pastor Bob went to that just about every Thursday. Now, inner city Detroit has a lot of poverty, and the people looked different than Pastor Bob. But Pastor Bob never said anything about why he was there. He just quietly did the work. He often found himself working with a young man. And the young man, after several months of working with him most Thursday nights, finally turned to look at him and said, "Why do you do this? Why do you come here? You don't look like us. You don't live here. Why do you come here and help us?" And Pastor Bob kept the focus on God and Jesus Christ. He said, "God loves me, and so I love God back by helping others. That's why I'm here, to be God's love." He didn't pat himself on the back. He pointed the way to God. He pointed the way to Jesus Christ. We know how to love because God sent Jesus Christ, and Jesus Christ taught us about God's love, focused on God's love, and encourages us to make loving God our focus, to let God's love direct our speech and our actions. May all of who we are point to God's loving arrival in Christ Jesus, because the life and teachings of Jesus Christ are why we celebrate the season of Advent and the gifts of Christmas. Let it be so. Amen. Let's sing together the carol, "Sing We Now of Christmas."
Sing we now of Christmas, Noel, sing we here. our grateful praises to the babe so dear. Sing we Noel, the King is born Noel. Sing we now of Christmas, sing we now Noel.
Call to shepherds, leave your flocks at rest. Journey forth to Bethlehem, find the child so blessed.
Sing we Noel,
the
King is born Noel. Sing we now of Christmas, sing we now Noel.
In Bethlehem they found him, Joseph and Mary mild, seated by the manger, watching the holy child.
Sing we Noel,
the
King is born Noel. Sing we now of Christmas, sing we now Noel.
From the eastern country came the kings afar, bearing gifts to Bethlehem, guided by a star.
Sing we Noel,
the
King is born Noel.
Sing we now of Christmas, sing we now
this morning's prayer, praises and concerns. First of all, praise for Sarah and her family. They are finding their way to healing and wholeness. Healing God, we thank you for working in Sarah and her family. We ask you to continue to work, to continue to guide them and lead them to your loving way. Thank you, God, for hearing our prayers. We also praise the fact that Verdi P's son has received a heart diagnosis and is receiving treatment. Thank you, God, for giving the doctors wisdom, showing them how to treat Verdi's son. Thank you that they are able to continue to treat him. Guide them so that he may continue to be healthy and regain his strength. Thank you, God, for hearing our prayers. Gail P's granddaughter, Ava, had two procedures on Friday, a laser treatment and a surgery on her lip, all because of Sturge-Weber syndrome. And she has a fourth eye surgery scheduled on the 21st of December for the glaucoma in her right eye, which is also caused by Sturge-Weber syndrome. And they're hoping that this surgery goes better. Gracious God, we pray for the wisdom of all those who, the doctors and nurses, technicians and aides, who will be assisting in Ava's surgery on the 21st. We thank you for all of their knowledge and wisdom as they treated Ava this past Friday. Continue to uphold her and heal her and keep her parents and her extended family in a sense of your peacefulness. Thank you, God, for hearing our prayers. We pray for the family of John O., Lee R's husband, who passed away due to COVID. We also pray for a former member, Margaret E., who passed away. Prayers for her husband, Jim, and the rest of her family. And we pray for a friend of Jack and Carol P., who passed away due to COVID this past week. God of all mercy and peace, enfold these people, your children, in your love, and grant them your peace, which passes all understanding. Remind them in the depth of their mourning that they are not alone. Even though it sometimes feels like it, you are always with them, and you will always be with them, holding them close to your breast in your love and compassion. Thank you, God, for hearing our prayers. We also want to continue to pray for Susan L., for both Sharon B.'s, for Ernie, for Shirley, for Linda P., for Carrie W. and her family, for Jack H., for Jason, Renee, Jean, Stephanie, and all medical workers and first responders. Gracious God, we ask you to be with each one of the people mentioned. Keep them on our hearts and minds in prayer, and give each one of them what they need, and show us how we may continue to minister to them through prayer, but also in other ways that we can reach out and show your love to them. Thank you, God, for hearing our prayers.
Holy One, complicated by a calendar too often void of joy, overshadowed by the events of this world, this season, rich with possibility, longs to be transformed into that which you have envisioned, a time of anticipation, a time of restoration. As witness to that which you have done before, evoking dreams and carefully planting joy and laughter, we pray that we may experience that of your people restored across history in the birth of the one who comes to deliver us. Our prayers rise to you, launched like joy from the tongues of prophets, joy in our words, joy in our breath, spontaneous and uncontainable, much like your love, O God. Reveal to us in the days to come a glimpse of your kingdom restored, where the dreams of your beloved children are realized, where hope and love abound, when and everywhere this new thing is birthed, and where joy is both recalled and anticipated, seated in memory and in vision, ready in our hearts, our mouths, and in all of our being. Fill these days of anticipation as we attend the holy birth. Remove complications and cast a new light with story upon story of what is possible with you alongside, soon to be revealed in good news and with great joy. In your many names we pray. Amen.
And now, each one in our own place, but saying this prayer all together, let us pray the prayer Jesus taught his disciples when he said, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen."
Now is the time we prepare our offerings to give to God. The day of rejoicing is coming, the prophet Isaiah says, and we await it together. Our gifts today in this season of waiting and hope help us to strengthen one another and to offer hope to the world as we look forward to that great day of everlasting joy. Let us gather our gifts together and present them as an offering to God. You may make donations at our website or by mailing them to the church.
Let us dedicate our offerings together. Let us pray. With these gifts, dear God, accept the praise and thanksgiving of our hearts, which rejoice in your goodness and love. Let these gifts point to your presence in the world and further your hope for the world through Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us. Amen. On the night before Jesus died, he was in an upper room with his disciples. They shared a meal together, the Passover. And as part of that meal, Jesus took bread and broke it, giving thanks for it and saying, "This is my body for you. Take it, eat it, and whenever you do, remember me." In the same way, Jesus took the cup. He blessed it and said, "This is the cup that represents my blood, which is shed for you. Take it, drink it, and whenever you do, remember me." The body of Christ for you. The cup of life for you. Let us give thanks for this feast that God has given us. Let us pray. Bountiful God, thank you for graciously feeding us at this table with the bread of life and the cup of eternal salvation. Strengthen us in your service. Share your glory and truth in our lives. Let us see you face to face in your kingdom. We offer ourselves to you as living sacrifices through Jesus Christ our Lord. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work for your praise and glory. Amen. Let us sing together the carol, "While by the Sheep We Watched."
Thank you.
Let us share our blessing for the week. Go forth with eyes to see and ears to hear and voices to proclaim in the work of justice. Jesus Christ, in the practice of mercy. Jesus Christ, in good news for the poor. Jesus Christ, in the vision of peace. Jesus Christ, we believe we exist to impact our world through God's love. Amen. Thanks be to God. And let us sing our response, Emmanuel, Emmanuel.
Emmanuel.